We're going to finish with the story of Easter this week. The whole semester we've been looking at that, and now here, the final week of chapel, we're going to get to the end of the story of Easter week, and it's a pretty remarkable ending. So remember where we left off last time was that Jesus had risen from the grave. He'd gotten back with his disciples, and he told them several things while he's with them. We talked about this before the spring break, but just to remind you what he told them, he said, first of all, you underestimated me. You didn't understand my calling. You didn't understand my purpose. You didn't understand my power, and you've underestimated what I came to do. They were with him. They were listening to his teaching. They loved all that. They were disciples. They followed him, but they did not really understand he was the Savior of the world. So he told them that. He said, essentially, you missed the main point. The main point is what I came to do, not just what I came to teach you. And then he said, read your Bible. And all through those 40 days from his resurrection to his ascension, see him pointing his disciples back to the Scripture. That reminds us, if Jesus thought Scripture was that important, we need to be reading our Bibles because it is God's Word to us. And then he thirdly told them to go and make disciples. That's your calling. That's your purpose. That's the reason that all this has happened, is to bring others to fellowship with God, that I can overcome death and I can forgive sin. And the proof is in the torn veil in the temple, that now you have fellowship with God. That's, oh God, it can be among us. And so go and make disciples because of that. And that's where we left off last time. And then the one last thing he told them was, I will be with you always. And that's what we want to talk about today. He said, I will always be with you. He said, I'm going to send the Holy Spirit. And we need to understand what that means, that Jesus sent the Holy Spirit, and what it means for us as followers of Christ and as our relationship with God grows and strengthens. So that's what we're going to look at. So we're going to begin looking at the Scripture, and it's a fairly long passage from John, but it's really important to understand. John 14 and 15, and this is Jesus talking to the disciples at the Last Supper. Now, this is before he was arrested and had the crucifixion, before his rising from the dead. So this is before that he's talking to them, and John records very carefully what Jesus said that night during the Last Supper. So let's follow along the screen. I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate who will never leave you. He's the Holy Spirit, who leads in all truth. The world cannot receive him because it isn't looking for him and doesn't recognize him. But you know him because he lives with you now and later will be in you. No, I will not abandon you as orphans. I will come to you. Soon the world will no longer see me, but you will see me. Since I live, you will also live. When I'm raised to life again, you will know. Now remember, this is before the crucifixion and the resurrection. When I'm raised to life again, you will know that I am my Father, and you are in me, and I am in you. I am the true grapevine, and my Father is the gardener. He cuts off every branch of mine that doesn't produce fruit, and he prunes the branches that do bear fruit so they will produce even more. You have already been pruned and purified by the message I have given you. Remain in me, and I will remain in you. For the branch cannot produce fruit if it's severed from the vine, and you cannot be fruitful unless you remain in me. But now I am going away to the one who sent me, and not one of you is asking where I'm going. Instead, you grieve because of what I've told you. But in fact, it's best for you that I go away, because if I don't, the advocate won't come. If I do go away, then I will send him to you. And when he comes, he will convict the world of sin and of God's righteousness and of the coming judgment. The world's sin is that it refuses to believe in me. Righteousness is available because I go to the Father, and you will see me no more. Judgment will come because the ruler of this world has already been judged. There is much more I want to tell you, but you can't bear it now. When the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you in all truth. You would think after 3 years, the disciples being with Jesus every single day, they would have understood, they would have learned, they would have been spiritual giants by that point, to walk and to talk with Jesus and to live with Jesus the whole time. You'd think they would just have grown in their faith enormously, but they still didn't get it. They still didn't get it. And after the resurrection, they were still asking immature questions that were about their needs, not about God's purposes in the world. This is what they asked Jesus. He said, so when the apostles were there with Jesus, they kept asking him, Lord, is the time come for you to free Israel and restore our kingdom? He replied, the Father alone has the authority to set those dates and times, and they are not for you to know. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be my witnesses, telling people about me everywhere, in Jerusalem, throughout Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. You see, Jesus was going to change everything about these disciples. They were immature in their faith, but when the power of the Holy Spirit came into their life, they took on the strength of God in their life, and they became witnesses. And they transformed the world by their message of being witnesses to the whole world. So there's a lot of complexity in all of this, and I could point you back to a whole bunch of scriptures, but we don't have time to do that. So trust me, all this is scripturally based, and you can dig into John 14, 15 and other places to find it, or I'll be happy to help you with it. But I want to give you four crucial understandings of that Jesus will be with us always by sending the Holy Spirit. The first is this. Jesus sent the Holy Spirit. Jesus purposely sent the Holy Spirit. Now, this is a tough concept. This is a theological concept to understand, but you got to get this clear. The Holy Spirit is God. Jesus is God. God is Jesus. God is the Holy Spirit. All three are God. The Bible is very clear that we have one God. There are not three gods. There's one God. But the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit are distinguished differently than each other in how they interact with God's people. All three persons of the Trinity are fully God. God is fully God. Jesus is fully God. The Holy Spirit is fully God. There is no difference in that. But so when Jesus said, I'm leaving you, but I need to go because I need to send the Holy Spirit, he was sending God back to them again in the same way that he had been with them. The Holy Spirit was just as real as Jesus. So he said, it's best that I go away. If I don't go away, you're not going to get the Holy Spirit to come with and be with you, and we need the Holy Spirit. They didn't see. They lived with Jesus for 3 years, and they didn't see all they needed to see. But he said, when the Holy Spirit comes, he will convict and he will guide you that you'll come into a deeper faith with God. So Jesus sends the Holy Spirit. And it's important for us to understand that he sends the Holy Spirit, but he's sending God just as Jesus was God. And again, I know it's a complex idea to understand, but you've got to grasp that. God, Jesus, the Holy Spirit, they're all three God in the same. So that's the first takeaway. Jesus left in order to send the Holy Spirit, to send God's presence back into the world. Then we see that the Holy Spirit lives in us because of Jesus' sacrifice for our sins. If Jesus hadn't been the sacrifice for our sins, we couldn't have the Holy Spirit. Because God is perfect and pure. And if you're going to have perfect and pure, that can't be sinful with sinful and unpure, or the purity is diluted. So the only way we can be in fellowship with God again is for Jesus to forgive us of our sins and to pay the sacrifice on the cross for us. So with that redeeming, we're able to be in fellowship with God, and that means God can be among us. Remember in the Old Testament, God was not among the people. He would come and be separate. Then in Jesus, he was there with them. And then remember when Jesus was crucified and said, "It's finished," the veil in the temple where the Holy of Holies was, that was the presence of God, was torn from top to bottom, and we became into the presence of God. That's what's happening here. The Holy Spirit lives in us because of the sacrifice of Jesus. Now, if you go back to John the Baptist, who was baptizing before Jesus came into full ministry, John the Baptist was Jesus' cousin, and John the Baptist says, "I baptize with water, but there's one coming after me who will baptize you with the Holy Spirit," is what John says. Not with water, but with the Holy Spirit. And when Jesus was baptized, he was fully immersed. So he went all the way, lifted down under the water and back up. And in that same baptism with the Holy Spirit, we are totally immersed in God's presence in our lives when the Holy Spirit comes into us. So the Holy Spirit is only possible, God living in us is only possible because of the redemption offered through Christ. The third takeaway is this: the Holy Spirit has three distinct roles in our life. Three distinct roles. Now, the Holy Spirit is living in us. That means God is living in us and through us as we're baptized with the Holy Spirit. So the Holy Spirit living in us has three roles in our life. The first is this: the Holy Spirit convicts of sin. Do you ever feel guilty? Do you ever do something that you were kind of mean to somebody, or something that didn't honor God, or something that you shouldn't have done, whatever it may be, and you feel guilty? That is the Holy Spirit working in you. That's a good thing, to know that God's presence is working in you. The scripture is real clear. If the Holy Spirit doesn't come for everyone, he comes for believers. God can't live in a non-believer because the non-believer hasn't been forgiven of sins because they haven't accepted Christ. And so if you're going to accept Christ, then you're forgiven of sins and you can have God's presence in you in the Holy Spirit. And in that, the Holy Spirit, first of all, convicts of sin. God's judgment is very real. And when God convicts us of sin, he's trying to prune us and to help us to cast off those things that keep us from producing the kind of fruit that honors him. So that's the process of the first thing the Holy Spirit does. The second thing the Holy Spirit does is by convicting of sin, so we cut off those parts that are not healthy and not growing, he then produces fruit in our lives. Scripture is very clear. He says he comes to produce fruit. You know, there are people who will say, "Well, I can't judge if somebody's a Christian." I hear this a lot in politics. "Well, I can't say if that person's a Christian or not." Yeah, I can. That's wrong. If you are a Christian, you show the fruit of Christian life. You show the fruit of the Holy Spirit, because you're connected to the vine. Now, that fruit may not be very well developed. That fruit may not be consistent. That fruit may not be the full gamut of all the fruit that could be in your life. There could be a lot more. But at least there's some fruit. And if you don't see the fruit of the Holy Spirit in somebody's life, they can't claim they're a Christian, because the Holy Spirit produces fruit in our lives. Now, the scripture is very clear what those fruits are. It's in Galatians. It puts it all down the list for us. The Holy Spirit, the scripture says, produces this kind of fruit in our lives: love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Those are the fruits of the Spirit that come into our lives when the Holy Spirit lives in us. Again, they may not be fully developed. They may need to grow more. They may not be the most perfect fruit there ever is, but that's what we're trying to do, is ask the Holy Spirit to continue to prune us by the conviction of sin, and then to grow that fruit in us. And then in that process, God gives us the power, is the third thing the Holy Spirit does. The scripture is very clear. The Holy Spirit convicts, produces fruit, and gives power. So the Holy Spirit gives power for what? For the Great Commission. The Great Commission is to go and make disciples. Go and tell the story. Be my witnesses. That's what God gives power for. So how do you be a witness for God and do what the Holy Spirit is to do in your life, which is to give you power to be a witness? How do you be a witness like that? You let the fruit develop and show through. We go back to the fruits again. Love, joy, patience, peace, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. That's how we witness. By how we live, it's not just by what you say. It's not by just quoting scriptures to people. It's by how you live and showing these fruits of the Spirit in your life. So the Holy Spirit gives power to make us witnesses. I think so often we pray, God, use your power to change my circumstances. I know I've prayed that. But that's not the real prayer. Instead of God, use your power to change my circumstances, God wants to use his power to transform lives of people around us as we're witnesses to them, because the stakes are a lot higher than simply my circumstances of today. The stakes are about eternity. And so the Holy Spirit comes with those three roles: to convict of sin, to produce fruit, and then to give us power to be witnesses. And when you put that together, that's when God works in our lives in remarkable ways and allows us to do things way beyond what we ever imagined God could do in our lives. Well, then the fourth idea of the Holy Spirit is that the Holy Spirit is with us now. The Holy Spirit is with us now. If you are a believer, if you believe in God and you've accepted Christ for forgiveness of sins, the Holy Spirit lives in you. What's that mean? The Holy Spirit lives in you. That's God lives in you. Remember, God, Jesus, the Holy Spirit, they're all God. They're all equally God and together God. I know it's a hard concept, but when we understand that concept that the Holy Spirit, which is God, lives in us because of the sacrifice of Jesus, so we can have fellowship with God, that changes everything. We forget that we're taking God with us wherever we go. Whatever you do, whatever you think about, whatever you say, God is with you. Would we live differently if we understood that God is really with us and in us in everything that we do? Then the scripture shows us, after saying this, he was taken up into a cloud while they were watching, and they could no longer see him. As they strained to see him rising into heaven, two white-robed men suddenly stood among them. Men of Galilee, they said, why are you standing here staring into heaven? Jesus has been taken away from you into heaven, but someday he will return from heaven in the same way he saw you go. He will return. He will return. That's the end of the Easter story. Jesus ascends into heaven, and then he sent the Holy Spirit. So until Jesus returns, the Holy Spirit will give us guidance, the Holy Spirit will give us purpose, and the Holy Spirit will give us power. And I pray that will be your prayer as well. And pray our benediction with that desire in mind. No eye has seen, no ear has heard, no mind has conceived what God has prepared for those who love him. Thank you for a good semester. God bless.